Hello and ciao ragazzi, and welcome to another video from Italy. It's my last morning here and I'm waiting for a tram in central Milan because my friend has told me about some strange experimental houses in the north of the city she thinks I should go and see before I leave. And that's what we're going to do. So if you enjoy this video, please do let me know in the comments, but more importantly, if you don't enjoy this video, then blame her. Stefania, I'm so sorry, it was just a joke, okay? Wait, what is un forcone and where do you want to put it? We're catching the tram from just outside Milano Centrale, Milan's monster central railway terminus, and we're going to travel just a few stops north on line 5. So it's only a short journey, but you know me, and I know my audience, when this thing turned up, there was no way I wasn't going to film it. This is one of the oldest trams still working in Milan, the 1500 series. They were built between 1927 and 1930, and based on the classic Peter Witt streetcar design from the USA. But this one isn't just some kind of novelty museum piece. There's over 130 of them here, still doing their regular job. Anyway, I could ride around on these all day, but unfortunately we can't, because I literally have a train home in a couple of hours. So instead, we're going to hop off here and try and find an igloo. I'm walking up a street called Viale Evaristo Steffini, and on first impressions, it's not a very promising looking street. With these big, uncompromising apartment blocks on both sides, cars taking up every last millimetre of space, and a busy railway line somehow jammed into a trench right down the middle. It all feels very cramped, very concrete, and very urban, and it doesn't seem like the kind of place you'd normally find an igloo. So what exactly is it doing here? Well, the short answer is, obviously, it's someone's house. And it's not the only one around, because if you go round the corner onto Via Lepanto, you'll find a few more of them. They were built back in 1946 by an Italian architect called Mario Cavallè. He'd been inspired by a new exciting American trend for circular homes, and he got permission to build a set of 12 of them on what was then the edge of the city. Originally, they were just bare white concrete, which is probably why people call them igloos, because if they'd had these orangey red roof tiles that they have now, I think we can all agree they would have been called pumpkins instead. And in case the igloo pumpkin homes weren't mad enough already, Cavallè also designed some mushroom-shaped houses nearby. Are you seriously telling me he was called Mario and he built that? Anyway, as far as I can tell, the mushrooms and the igloos were almost identical structures. The main difference being that the mushrooms had both floors above ground, which made them look like mushrooms, while the igloos had their lower floor sunken into the ground, which made them look like igloos. But fundamentally, they were all designed the same way because they were all supposed to solve the same problem. And a valid question at this point is, what on earth was the problem if this was the solution? Well, it's 1946, so the Second World War has just ended, but now governments everywhere are facing a massive housing crisis. Because one of the things about wars is that while they're going on, the rate of construction of new homes tends to go right down, but the rate of destruction of existing homes tends to go right up. And pretty soon, I think you've worked this out already, there are no longer enough homes for all the people. Now, if you are a post-war government, you don't really have to worry too much about the rich, because they live in nice suburbs that generally escape the bombings, and they've all got second and third homes anyway. You do have to worry about people on lower incomes, but history tells us you'll just stick up masses of cheap, quick, ugly buildings, they'll move in because they don't really have a choice, and you can forget about them until a decade or two later when those cheap buildings start falling apart, but hey, that'll be someone else's problem by then. That leaves one group. What about the middle classes?
They're building some new homes, Giacinta. Riccardo, dear, I will not be seen in a cheaply built residence.
No, Giacinta. We do need to live somewhere, though.
I'm obviously exaggerating, but there's a genuine question here. How can you build homes cheaply and quickly for the kind of people who won't live in a cheap, quickly built home? Well, it turns out there was one way you could answer that question. Igloos!
Oh, yes.
The genius of Cavallè's idea was that these houses were quick and easy to build, but they were also modern and trendy enough to invite your friends around for organic chickpea and avocado salad. And another part of the appeal, strange though it might sound, is that it would be just as quick and easy to take them down again. The igloos were designed from the start to be temporary. The intention was that within a few decades, the owners would demolish their home and replace it with a more conventional one. And that's exactly what happened to some of them. If you look at the area on Google Maps satellite view, you can see quite clearly where four igloos used to be. And if you look at the area in real life, you can see what replaced them. But despite the genius of Mario's idea, it completely failed to catch on anywhere else. And these are the only examples of his design ever constructed. So before anyone could demolish any more of them, heritage fans stepped in to save the remaining eight, which are now protected by law. Unfortunately, it was too late to save the mushrooms. They'd already gone. In fact, there is a story floating around that it was Mario's own younger brother who demolished them. Apparently, he'd ended up working in local government and gave the orders to get rid. I'm unable to confirm that story or, more importantly, whether he was called Luigi, so if anyone knows more about it, please do let us know. But a few decades later, three brand new mushrooms sprung up in another suburb further out, albeit with some minor changes to the original design. And so, Mario Cavallo's experiment lives on, and the eight historic igloos and the three new mushrooms remain in use as private residences today. I'm not sure if that makes them a failure as temporary homes, or a success as permanent ones. I'll leave you to consider this existential debate in the comments. If you'd like to visit the igloos of Milan, you can do what I did and catch the Line 5 tram, or you can catch the Line 5 metro to either Marche or Istria station. Whichever option you pick, it'll be a 10-minute walk to get to the igloos. The mushrooms, meanwhile, are out near Komazina station at the end of Line 3. Both metro lines have totally step-free access, the vintage trams, not quite so much. And don't forget, these are still people's homes, so please respect that, and don't all go there at once. Until next time, thank you very much for watching, and I will see you soon.